So hello everyone, today's class is about instruments in periodontal surgery. So we'll be talking about only those instruments that we'll be using during the surgical procedures. So in that, we have a classification. So the instruments that are used in the periodontal surgery are classified into excisional and incisional instruments, surgical curette and sickles, periosteal elevators, surgical chisels, surgical files, scissors, hemostats and tissue forceps, and later we'll see some miscellaneous instruments. So now first we'll start with the excisional and incisional instruments. So the instruments that are used for excising the tissue and the instruments that are used for giving the incisions, okay, the blades that are used for giving incisions. In that, first we'll start with the periodontal knives. These are also called as gingivectomy knives. A very important MCQ that is asked is Kirkland knife and another knife called as Orban's knife. We'll see later. So Kirkland knife and Orban's knife, these are used for the purpose of gingivectomy. Okay, so these are the two main knives. You need to remember these names, Kirkland knives and Orban's knife. So these knives may be available in a double-ended form or a single-ended form. So only the single end is having the cutting edge, or else both the ends can be used. So it can be single-ended or double-ended. In the Kirkland knives, it is kidney shaped. Okay, so the entire periphery of the knife is having the cutting edge. So this entire periphery can be used. And this Kirkland knife is especially effective on the retromolar region. So we have Kirkland knife, we have Orban's knife. Another question asked is, Kirkland knife is used on the facial surface for the gingivectomy purpose. Okay, whereas the other knives that we have are the Orban's knife, Merrifield knife, and Goldman Fox knives. These are used for the interdental areas. So we have seen that the Kirkland knife is used on the facial surface, which is an important question, whereas the Orban's knife, Merrifield's knife, and the Goldman Fox knife are used in the interdental areas. So this is the Orban's knife. So Kirkland knife is having a kidney shape, right? Whereas this is the Orban's knife, this is the Merrifield knife, and this is the Goldman Fox knife. So you need to remember the Orban knife and Kirkland knife, pictures of these two. Okay, so these are the spear shaped knives, and they have cutting edges on both the sides of the blade. So they can be designed same, the double-ended or the single-ended instruments, and they are having the cutting edges on both the sides of the blade. Next, so what are the gingivectomy knives? We have to remember the Kirkland knife, Orban's knife, Goldman Fox, Merrifield, and we even have Buck's knife. In this, the important things are Kirkland, Orban's, and Merrifield. You need to remember this three names. So these are the knives that are used for gingivectomy. Orban's knife, Goldman Fox, Merrifield, they are all used in the interdental areas, where a Kirkland knife is used on the facial aspect. Yeah, so next are the surgical blades. So these are used for giving incisions. So the most commonly used blades are the 12D blade, 15 and 15C. 12D, 15 and 15C are most commonly used scalpel blades. So here you can see the difference. See, the 10 is having very broad blade, 11 is having a narrow blade, 12 is having some curved kind of blade, isn't it? So curved shape is there. So the 11 blade is used in the anterior region. So this is called as sword type. So isn't it? It's looking like a sword shape. Okay, so sword type, 11 blade is used in the anterior region, whereas it is like a sickle, isn't it? The 12 blades are like a sickle type. So this sickle type 12 blade is used in the posterior region. 12D is also used in the posterior region. So what is the difference in between 12 and 12D? 12D is having cutting edges on both the sides, and it allows us to use in the narrow interdental area. So in the narrow restricted areas, we can use the 12D. 12 and 12D both are used in the posterior region, but 12D is having cutting edges on both the aspects, which allows us to engage the narrow restricted areas, especially the interdental areas can be engaged with the help of 12 blade. Next one is a 15 number blade. This is called as a universal blade. So this is used for all the general purposes, for all kinds of incisions. For the general purposes, we can use. It is used for thinning flaps and all-round use. That is a general use. Okay. There is another. This is 15-number blade. Okay. 15C blade is a curved blade. As you can see, the difference in between 15 and 15C. 15C is a curved kind of blade, and it is considered as a narrow version of 15 blade. Isn't it? So 15 is like this. 15C is a narrower version of 15 number plate, and this is used for anterior region partial thickness flaps. So this is used in the anterior region and for the purpose of partial thickness flaps. So first we are giving incisions. So after incisions, we may elevate full thickness flap or a partial thickness flap. So now what is partial thickness flap? In this, we are not exposing the bone. Okay, whereas in case of full thickness, we are completely elevating the flap and exposing the bone. So this 15C is used for partial thickness flaps, not for full thickness. Okay, also it can be used for making initial kind of incision. Initial incision can also be made with a 15C plate. Okay, so what is the purpose of this narrow design? Again, so this narrow design allows us for incising the interdental areas of the flaps. Okay, so usually the narrower designs of the plates are used for the giving incisions in the interdental regions. Okay, same like 12 and 12D. So now we have seen blades. Where do we place these blades? We are placing the blades to a handle. So there should be some handle to hold the blade, right? So here we have two kinds of handles. This is a straight handle. This is having some angle. So this is called as offset angle. So in case of posterior regions, we can't use the straight kind of blade. Okay, so in such cases, in posterior regions especially, and even in the palatal aspects, we will be using the blade with some angulation. So straight angle and the offset angle blade holders. That is a scalpel handles. Okay, so to this, we will be attaching the blade. Okay. Yeah. So next we have seen the excisional and incisional instruments, under which we have seen the gingivectomy knives, and we have also studied about blades. Now is surgical curettes. So what is the use of curettes? It is used for removing the granulation tissue. It is used for removing the deposits, the calculus and all. Okay. So these surgical curettes include the larger and heavier curettes and sickle kind of scalers. So what is the purpose of these curettes and sickles? They are used for the removal of granulation tissue. They are used for removal of fibrous interdental tissues and also tenacious subgingival deposits. So first, if you have to understand the use of these instruments, you need to understand the steps of surgery first. First, we are giving incision. Okay, so we are placing the blade like this. Okay, so we are incising. We are giving incision. We are passing the blade all through this area. So we are giving incisions. Okay, so after giving incisions, we will reflect the flap. So the flap will come like this. Yeah, so we are reflecting the flap, which is present in this position. We are reflecting the flap. We are moving the flap away in order to look into this area. So what is the main aim of the flap surgery? It may be axis flap surgery. That means in some patients, there are subgingival calculus deposits. So just if we perform scaling, wherein we are removing the supragingival calculus deposits, the disease won't subside. We have to remove the deposits that are present beneath the gingiva, the subgingival calculus deposits. Okay, in such cases, what you do, you elevate the flap, you will remove all the subgingival deposits, then you will place the flap back into the position and suture. This is called as axis flap. That means just for the purpose of axis, just for the purpose of visibility, in order to clean everything, you're doing a flap. This is axis flap. Another thing is regenerative flap. So here what you're doing is, again, you're giving incision, you're reflecting the flap. Then what you do is you will remove, for any flap, you will be removing the calculus deposits. You will be removing the granulation tissue that is present. Okay, so once you remove this calculus deposits, granulation tissue, the bleeding will stop. So once you give incisions, once you elevate the flap, there will be profuse bleeding. Once you remove the granulation tissue, the bleeding will stop. So after removing the granulation tissue and calculus deposits, you will be able to view the bone. Okay, so if there are any bone defects, you can place the bone graft in that area. So this is called as regenerative kind of surgery. So you're trying to regenerate the lost periodontal attachment, isn't it? So by placing the bone graft, by placing the membrane, you are regenerating. Okay, so there is another kind of surgery which is called as resective, wherein you will be performing the bone shaping. So in order to do shaping or else in order to place the bone graft, what do you need? You need a clear access to the bone. Isn't it? If you do not see the bone, you cannot repair the bone. You cannot regenerate or you cannot resect. So first you need to see the bone. In order to see the bone, you need to remove all the subgingival calculus deposits, you need to remove the granulation tissue, whatever the fibrous interdental tissues are there, all these have to be removed, for which you are using these curettes and sickles. Okay, so first, for the purpose of incisions, we are using blades, or else if we are performing gingivectomy. So yesterday in the pocket class, we have seen that there are fibrous kind of pockets. So in these fibrous kind of pockets, we will be performing the gingivectomy. If there is coronal movement of the gingival margin, in order to remove that excess gingiva, we are performing gingivectomy, removing the gingiva, excising the gingiva. For that purpose, we are using the knives. Okay, so we have excised, we have reflected the flap. Then later, what you have to do, you have to thoroughly debride. So in the process of debridement, you are removing the granulation tissue, calculus deposits. Okay. So for this, in these surgical curettes, we have the Kirkland surgical instruments, Pritchard's curette, and we also have the ball scaler. So Kirkland surgical instruments and Pritchard's curette are the commander curettes. They are the heavy curettes. Okay. So they are used for removing the calculus deposits, granulation tissue, etc. Whereas the ball scaler is kind of sickle. It's a heavy sickle. So these instruments are having wider and heavier blades, which help us in removing the tenacious calculus deposits. Thick subgingival deposits can be removed. So these are the Kirkland surgical instruments, Kirkland curettes. Okay. So this is just for purpose of your understanding, I'm showing. So in this, you need to remember this Pritchard's curette. Okay, so this is the Pritchard's curette. So this is having a broader ends when compared to the scalers that are used for scaling and root planing. So we have the scalers and curettes that are used for scaling and root planing. Compared to those, this is having the wider and heavier plate. This Pritchard's curette is having the wider and heavier plates. Next is the elevator. So this should actually come in front. Okay, so after giving incisions, we are elevating the flap, right? So for the purpose of elevating the flap, for the purpose of moving the flap away, we are using the periosteal elevators. So what is their purpose? Their purpose is to reflect and move the flap after the incisions have been made for the flap surgery. So once you are giving the incisions, after incisions, you have to reflect the flap, isn't it? So just imagine, you might have seen extractions. Okay, so for that, what you'll do, you'll first reflect the flap, isn't it? You'll straight away use the periosteal elevator. In most of the cases, you won't be giving incisions. Straight away, you'll be using the periosteal elevator and reflecting the flap, and then giving the, then you will try to remove the tooth, luxate the tooth, isn't it? So this periosteal elevators are same as that of that one used in extraction. Okay, so these are used to reflect and move the flap after the incisions have been made. So in this, we have the Woodson's elevator and the Pritchard's elevator. So here is the Woodson's elevator and this is the Pritchard's elevator. So Pritchard's elevator is having a more broader end, okay, when compared to the Woodson's periosteal elevator. Next is the surgical chisels and hoes. So these are used during the periodontal surgery in order to remove the bone and reshape the bone. So in the purpose of osteoplasty procedures, wherein you will be shaping the bone, or osteectomy, wherein you will be removing the bone. So in such cases, you will be using this surgical chisels and hoes. Okay, so in that you have some chisel names you need to remember. Weddellstad chisel, another one is Oxenbein chisel. Oxenbein chisel number 1 and 2. So these two chisel names you have to remember. So here, these are used for removing and reshaping the bone. So in this, the main things you need to remember is some of them have a curved shank and blade. The Weddellstad is having a straight shank. And another important thing is chisels are used with a push stroke motion. Okay, chisels are used with a push stroke motion, whereas hoes are used with a pull stroke motion. This is another important point. So hoe is used in a pull stroke, chisels are used in a push stroke. So what is the instrument that is used in pull stroke? That is hoe. Push stroke motion is used for chisels. Okay, so why is the hoe used? Hoe is used mainly for detaching the pocket walls after the gingivectomy incision. So in case of fibrous pockets, we are performing the gingivectomy in case of gingival enlargements. So after giving the gingivectomy incision, the pocket wall, okay, so here, so once you are excising this is the pocket wall, the inner aspect is a pocket wall. So in order to detach this pocket wall, we are using the hose. It is also used for smoothing the root and bone surfaces, and so that it will help us in providing the accessibility. So Ho is used for detaching the pocket walls after the gingivectomy incision. It is used for smoothing the root and bone surfaces. Whereas the Oshkin bone chisel is having, I'll show you the Oshkin bone chisel in the picture. So it is having a semicircular indentation on both the sides of the shank, and it will help, it will allow the instrument to get engaged into the tooth and into the interdental area. So in case of surgical chisels, you need to remember three names: Weddell-Stead chisel, Oshkin bone chisel, and Rhodes chisel. Remember these three names. Okay. So surgical chisels and hoes. Chisels are used with a push motion, whereas hoes are used with a pull motion. Okay. So these are the different kinds of chisel. So just remember this picture, the Oshkin bone chisel. Okay. So this is a very important picture. It might be asked in your image-based questions. Okay. So the sharp chisels are available in various sizes and shapes. As you can see here, they are of different sizes and shapes. So based on the purpose, based on the type of treatment that we are planning, we need to appropriately select a instrument, whether it is angled instrument or a straight instrument. So this is the Rhodes chisel. Okay. Next, we'll talk about surgical files. So in surgical files, you need to remember again two important names: Schlugerman file and Sugarman file. Okay, so Schluger is having a bit curved. You'll get confused with both, but Schluger is having a little bit of curved end like this, whereas Sugarman is having a straight end. So these are used to smoothen the bone. They are used to smooth the rough bony ledges and to remove all areas of the bone. So I have told you about one point called as resective osseous surgery. So there is regenerative osseous surgery, resective osseous surgery. So what is the purpose of resective osseous surgery? So the bone should be smooth. It should be well adapted to the tooth surface. In some cases, when there are bony ledges, and if you won't smooth the bone and place the flap as it is onto that irregular bony surface, then there will be formation of pockets. So in such cases, the irregular bony surfaces have to be smoothened. So for such purposes, you have to perform the osteoplasty and osteectomy technique. So there are different steps again, which we'll talk in other classes. But remember that for the purpose of resective osseous surgery, you will perform osteoplasty, that is smoothening of the bone, or you will remove some amount of bone. For that purpose, you will use this surgical files. So they are used to smooth the rough bony ledges and also used to remove some areas of bone. So this is the Schlugerman file and this is the Sugarman file. Schluger and Sugar. Okay. They are used interproximally and they might be used with push or a pull stroke. So next we'll talk about scissors and nippers. So these scissors, after we elevate the flap, we have to trim the margins of the flaps. So in order to trim these margins of the flap, or in order to remove some tissue, tabs of the tissue, we will be using these scissors. Okay. So if suppose there is a periodontal abscess and you're giving incision and drainage, in order to enlarge these incisions, after giving the incisions, in order to enlarge these incisions also, we can use the scissors. They may also be used in removing the muscle attachments in case of mucogingival surgery. So mainly to remove the tabs of the tissue, trim the margins of the flaps. So after you elevate, you are elevating the flap like this. So in order to trim the margins of the flaps, okay, then you'll be using these scissors, or else to enlarge the incisions that are used in the periodontal abscesses, removing the muscle attachments during the mucogingival surgery. Okay, so in this, the common type of scissor that you have to remember is a Goldman Fox scissor. Okay, I'll show you the picture. So these are the different kinds of nippers that are shown. The main thing you have to remember is this Goldman Fox scissor. So this is the conventional scissor, that is a Goldman Fox scissor in case of conventional surgery, whereas this is the scissor that is used in the microsurgery. Okay, so if you're performing microsurgery, that is under the microscope, with the help of loops, usually you will use this kind of scissor. So these are both used to remove the tabs of the tissues. The same uses, but this is the conventional Goldman Fox scissor, whereas this is the scissor that is used in case of microsurgery, periodontal microsurgery. Okay, so next is the needle holder. So what all we have seen, we have given incisions, that might be with the help of knives or with the help of blades. We have used the elevators to move the flap, isn't it? With the help of periosteal elevators, Woodson elevator and the Pritchard's elevator. Next, we have thoroughly debrided it. Okay, we have used the surgical curettes and sickles, and we have shaped the bone, isn't it? So with the help of what did we use for shaping the bone? We have used, we even have the burrs also. Not only those, not only this conventional instruments, we have osteoplasty burrs also, which I'll be showing you. So we have used different kinds of surgical chisels, hose in order to shape the bone. We have used the Sugarman and Sugarman files also. So later, after everything is done, so if needed, we'll be placing the bone graft and we will suture the flap. For the purpose of suturing the flap, we need needle holder. So in order to hold that suture needle, we need the needle holders, isn't it? So they are used to suture the flap at the desired position after the surgical procedure has been completed. So what is meant by desired position? We may place the flap back into its original position. That is, prior to surgery, what is the position of the flap? We may place it back. That is called as undisplaced flap. Okay. Or we may displace the flap. In the displaced flap, we have two kinds: apically displaced flap or laterally displaced flap. Okay. So finally, like with the help of needle holders, we are holding the surgical needle. We are using the suture needle and we are suturing the flap back to desired position wherever we need. So we may displace the flap or undisplace the flap. Okay. So here, this is again the conventional needle holder. So for regular surgery, we'll be using this kind of needle holder. Okay. Whereas for the purpose of microsurgery, we will be using this needle holder. This is called as Castrovisio needle holder. Okay. So this is used for the conventional surgery. Okay. Whereas this is used for the microsurgery. This is called as Castrovisio needle holder. You need to remember these pictures. Only specific kind of image-based questions might be asked. Whatever the pictures that are given in Karanja are mostly asked. So that is why I'm only emphasizing those pictures. Okay. Next, some miscellaneous instruments we'll be seeing. So we have finished the main surgical instruments. We'll see some of the other instruments. First one is pocket marker. Okay. So pocket marker is used to mark the pockets. Okay. So if in case of gingivectomy, what you do is, suppose, yeah. So if this is the level of the gingiva, you want to perform the gingivectomy. What you do is, first you need to place a periodontal probe. So you will place a periodontal probe into the pocket, into the sulcus. Then you will be knowing the apical end of the pocket, isn't it? So pocket is somewhere here. Okay, the pocket is somewhere here. Then what you do is, you will mark this pocket. You may mark it with the on the external surface with the probe, or else you can use the pocket marker. So in place of probe, you will be inserting this pocket marker into the sulcus so that you can mark the base of the pocket. Okay, so it is used to establish exterior puncture mark on the gingiva at the base of the pocket. So what is happening? So here you are marking here. Suppose the pocket is somewhere here, here, here. So you will be marking the base of the pocket. According to that, you will be giving the initial line of incision. So you may just use the probe and mark the pocket, mark the base of the pocket. So from the inner side, you will be placing the probe into the sulcus. You will know the base of the pocket. Then with the help of same probe, you're marking, you're making an exterior puncture. Or you can use a Goldman Fox periodontal pocket marker with which you can mark the base of the pocket. Okay. Next, membrane placement instrument. So what is membrane? So for the purpose of GTR, that is a guided tissue regeneration, what we'll do is we'll place a membrane. Okay. So this membrane, for the purpose of regeneration, we might use only the membrane, or we might use both the bone graft plus membrane. Bone graft along with the membrane. So in this membrane, there are again different materials that are used: chorion membrane, amnion membrane. So different kinds of membranes. So for the purpose of placement of this membrane, we will be using this membrane placement instrument. So this is having a spike end and a curved end. So this is specially designed for the placement of the guided tissue regeneration membrane. So the spike end will hold the material, that is a membrane, in place. So this is used for the purpose of guided tissue regeneration membrane. Okay. Next, Next is the suture pliers. Okay, so these are called as corn suture pliers. So they are used for holding the flap. So what happens is, if suppose there is a flap here, so you will be placing the corn suture plier, and then through this hole you will be passing the needle, suture needle. Okay, so these are used for holding the flap, and they are present with a hole with a plier beak needle, so that the plier beak needle can be passed through. So you will be holding the flap with this, and through this hole you will be passing the suture needle. So these are called as suture pliers. Okay, so these are the additional instruments that can be used while performing the periodontal surgery. Okay, next. So suture pliers are help us in passing the suture needle. Okay, next is the Adson's tissue pliers. So these are called as tissue forceps. So they are used to grip the fine, delicate flaps while limiting the soft tissue trauma. So in order to hold the flaps, you will be using this fine instrument, that is the tissue pliers. So in this, again, there are two types, toothed and non-toothed. Okay, so toothed will have a tooth-like beak here, whereas non-toothed will have a plain edge. Okay, so in case of these tissue pliers are used to hold the flaps. So in this, there are two types, toothed and non-toothed. Okay, next. Yeah, next is the graft pliers. So these pliers also hold the gingival flap without damage. So these are also just to hold the flap only, just like the tissue forceps. These are also used to hold the gingival flap without damage, as the regular hooked tweezers easily damage the tissues. So instead of using the tweezers, regular kind of instruments, these graft pliers can be used. They are even more gripping, and they do not damage the tissue. So they have a good grip with which we can hold the gingival flap. So without causing any trauma, they are even more atraumatic. Okay. So next is the osseous surgery instruments. So as I have told you, we can use the files, surgical files, and there are also some carbide burrs that can be used for osseous surgery. So these include different kinds of burrs that are used for osteoplasty and osteectomy. Okay. So next is a microsurgery instrument. So in that we have already seen two, the needle holder and the blades, the Castrovision needle holder, isn't it? So in this, there are these microsurgical instruments. So what is microsurgery? Microsurgery is a surgery that is performed under magnification. So for this magnification, we may use microscope or we may use loops. Okay. So in that, we cannot use, when we are performing the microsurgery, we cannot use this conventional blades, conventional instruments. So for that, there are different kinds of, microsurgical instruments. So here is the blade breaker, crescent and mini crescent knives, 260 degree spoon, lamella and sclera. Okay, so these are the different kinds of instruments. There's no problem, even if you don't remember the names, just understand the concept that conventional instruments are different, microsurgical instruments are different. So if you are performing the surgery under magnification, you will be using the microsurgical instruments. Okay. And this microsurgery, an important concept is, it has originated from ophthalmology. Okay, so from the ophthalmological instruments are usually used for this, even the periodontal microsurgery. So these instruments are very tiny. Okay, so under magnification, we have to use only these instruments. Yeah, so here we end with the topic. So first, you need to remember the steps of the periodontal surgery, that is the incision, flap reflection, debridement, and then regenerative or resective surgery, the goal of your surgery, whether it is access flap surgery, regenerative or resective surgery, then you need to place the flap back into the position and give the suture. Okay, so if you remember this order, you will be able to remember the instruments.